After all these years, this thing finally fits. I got this shirt when I was 11 years old at the Kiss Alive 35 concert. However, this was the only size they had and it was too big for me. So I kind of avoided wearing it up until now when I realized, oh shit, I'm 25 years old, I'm fat, and can probably fit in this thing, and I do. Why are we here? Well, to kind of celebrate the end of Kiss in a positive manner. 50 years of them being a band, I decided to give you my 50 favorite Kiss songs. Not necessarily the top 50 Kiss songs, just the 50 favorites of mine that over the years I just have been listening to on a consistent basis. So I'm just letting you know that right now. This list is based upon my opinion. This is not a right list, and that's all you really need to know going into this. There are three honorable mentions I want to talk about because, you know, I feel like two of these songs have just gotten overplayed to hell to where I just couldn't put them on this list because it'd be too obvious. And there's one where it's a catchy song, but the lyrics are a little questionable. The two overplayed songs are Rock and Roll All Night and Beth. I mean, yeah, those songs are Kiss classics in their own. I mean, they play Rock and Roll All Night at the end of every show now. And Beth was pretty much the band's biggest hit. I still think is the band's biggest hit to date. The Peter Criss-led track, the more ballady type track. And those are the two Kiss songs that the radio plays when it's like, no, they have other hit songs that you can be playing other than just those two, but whatever, those have been beaten into my brain, and I just couldn't find myself to put them on this list. However, I do realize that if you ask a non-Kiss fan, hey, name a Kiss song, they're gonna name one of these two, and maybe even I Was Made for Loving You, but that one isn't as overplayed as those two are. Now, the third song we're gonna talk about is a good song, but the lyrics can be questionable, and that is Christine 16. I've always loved the instrumental, especially the guitar riff, but most of the song is just Gene Simmons talking about how he wants to get with this 16-year-old girl, and there's even this whole portion in the song where he monologues about waiting for the girl to get out of school so he can, you know, take her home and, you know, do some things. And it's never really classified whether he's in this secret relationship with the 16-year-old or he's just stalking the 16-year-old. So, yeah, it's one of those songs that when I was younger, didn't bat an eye at the lyrics, but once I start getting into high school, I was like, you know, this is really, really weird. Why would anybody ever sing along to this? I don't know. Like I said, it just stinks because it's a good song overall when you take the lyrics out. But with the lyrics in there, it's kind of like, yeah, I don't know if I want to be too associated with this song to begin with. So with the honorable mentions out of the way, let's start it off at number 50. We have Within. This is a, I don't know if you can really call it deep cut off of Psycho Circus. Psycho Circus didn't have a lot of singles, but this song was actually one of the leftover demos from the Carnival of Souls era that Gene Simmons had in his pocket, and I guess after it not making that record, they decided to put it on Psycho Circus to, I guess, add to the track listing, because it doesn't really sound a lot like what you would get on Psycho Circus. I mean, this is supposed to be a return to form in one way or another, was this album, and with Within, you're getting a more grungier, kind of chuggier type song, although fits Gene Simmons very well, and it's always been one of my favorites. It's just kind of been the oddball of that record when you think about it, but nonetheless, it still slaps. Then we have the Paul Stanley-led song, Do You Love Me, sitting here at number 49. This song is interesting because the lyrics are pretty self-explanatory. It's nothing, like, you have to, like, look into. It's basically Paul Stanley listing off things that this girl that he's with likes about him. You know, his cars, his money, and all that stuff. But in the end, he kind of, like, confronts her and says, look, I know you like all that, but do you love me? Do you love the person? If not, then I don't know if this is going to work out because it seems you're just using me for my material things. This is the song that finishes off Destroyer, which is by far Kiss's best record, even though not one of their most experimental. I guess back then it was definitely different from what they were able to do, but I feel like this is more of the classic Kiss sound that you would get from the records that came before this, and overall just had a nice tone to it, and they were able to make this very, very catchy. Now we have one off of Dynasty, a record that, you know, I feel like when it first came out was hated, but over the years it's kind of grown a cult following. There's still haters out there for this record, obviously, because this is supposedly Kiss's disco record, and although I can say there are songs that lean more toward the disco side of things, like Dirty Livin', I Was Made for Lovin' You, and Sure Know Something, a lot of this record just has Kiss doing more of a pop rock type feel than disco, and Charisma, even though is on the verge of being a disco song, or kind of is a disco song, it's a nice song nonetheless. This is one of the few tracks on Dynasty that Gene Simmons had lead vocals, as he was not really down with the whole sound that this record was going for. So this and X-Ray Eyes were the only two songs he sang on. And there's just something about this song. I mean, I guess it's just the, you know, callback or chanting of what is my charisma that really gets the song going. Plus, Gene Simmons' vocals are a little bit different. Other than being growly in his, you know, demon persona, he kind of shows more of his singing, more melodic voice, and I think that's what makes the song different from a lot of Gene Simmons songs. It just works so well. At number 47, we have the newest song on this list, Modern Day Delilah, which kicks off their 2009 comeback record, Sonic Boom. This is the first album to feature the current lineup of Paul Stanley, Gene Simmons, Eric Singer, and Tommy Thayer. And I gotta say, when I first heard this song popping in the album for the first time when I was 11 years old, I said, hell yeah, Kiss has still got it. Sadly, the rest of the record was really hit or miss, but Modern Day Delilah has always been the one to me that's just packed the most punch from that. Like, if there was ever a mainstay of songs that could come from the last two Kiss records, it would be this one for the pure fact that it just sounded like classic Kiss. You know, you got more of Gene Simmons and Tommy Thayer kind of, you know, singing the chorus together while Paul Stanley kind of adds to it. And when Paul Stanley goes in the verses, his vocals may be a little shot, but they're not bad to the tone of being unlistenable. Like, it's a nice song, and I feel like it should get more appreciation for being the best song off of Sonic Boom. We have our first song of the No Makeup Era, that being All Night off of Asylum. I know that was a little cringy, but that's kind of how they say it. Let's just say it's All Night. Weird song title, I know, but, you know, with this kind of being a more, you know, mainstream hit, they couldn't say, you know, fuck All Night or whatever. They had to just add that sound effect in to get you realizing, like, oh, that's what they mean. Basically, again, the song is about just, you know, a guy working a 9-to-5 job. He comes home, he's miserable, and, you know, sometimes you just need to, you know, get things out of your system, and sometimes that involves doing the dirty deed. And I don't know what it is. I think it's more the chorus that uplifts this song more than anything else, because when you listen to the verses, it kind of sounds almost like they took from the song Dancing in the Street with David Bowie and Mick Jagger, just by the way Paul Stanley's vocal tones and the way things are sung in the chorus sound. But once you get to that chorus, you're like, oh yeah, this was Kiss doing the whole hair metal, glam metal thing in a correct way. I mean, are the lyrics cheesy? Yeah, but that's what you come to expect from glam and hair metal at that point in time. Number 45, someone say this is the heaviest Kiss song, and it's weird because Gene Simmons wrote this song, of course, and sang on it, but it was also co-written by the Bryan Adams. You know it's true, everything I do it for you. yes, that Bryan Adams. It surprised me too, but there's a couple of songs on Creatures of the Night that Bryan Adams actually co-writes, and they're not bad songs. And this one is definitely, when you talk about Kiss toward the end of their, like, time in the makeup, what song really stands out, it's this one. They still go back to this song now because, I don't know what it is, the drums are just so powerful. I mean, I've talked about it before. One of the highlights on Creatures of the Night is Eric Carr's drumming, and you get that with the little, you know, just guitar riff that's just so chuggy, and it's just so, like, deep that it makes everything so eerie, and you kind of understand the sound that the band was going for in general. And plus, Gene Simmons singing this song, like, no other member of Kiss could have sang this song. It had to be him. Is the closer on the Dynasty record, Save Your Love, the Ace Frehley-led track. Ace Frehley actually had a lot more time on lead vocals on Dynasty than he ever had, as before that album, the only time we had heard him on lead vocals for Kiss was Shock Me on Love Gun, and of course, I mean, he had a solo record, but Dynasty, he took lead vocals 3 times, and that includes the album finisher here. And basically, this song, Ace Frehley's just shouting his way about a girl who, I guess, wronged him in some way, and he's just saying, you know what, I don't want your love, save it for somebody else, because I don't deserve you, you don't deserve me, and it's over. It's a nice way to kind of end a record that had all these kind of, you know, positive notions to it, kind of throwing that one in there to throw you for a loop a little bit. It's nice, and the fact that, you know, Ace Frehley kind of shows us a different vocal tone was also nice to hear too. I Want You, which is the opener to the 1976 album Rock and Roll Over. This album saw Kiss pretty much abandon what they did on Destroyer, being more experimental and just going back to basics. And of course, it starts with the acoustic portion that Paul Stanley sings into just the rest of the song, which I think is nice, can be repetitive at times. But when you look at Kiss and how they used to do things, especially on their first 3 records, it was just sing a lot of the chorus while the verses are short and sweet and to the point, and add some solos in there. And I Want You is definitely always one that I've liked. Speaking of album openers that I think are underrated, we have Room Service off of Dressed to Kill. There's just something fun about it. I mean, again, I know the lyrics are a little raunchy. It's about, you know, oh, the show's over, I'm going back to my hotel, I'm tired, but yet this girl comes knocking at my door and says, hey, do you want some room service? And it's like a 3-minute track, but it does its job as an album opener, pretty much letting you know what Dressed to Kill as an album is going to sound like as a whole. Oh no. Every time you mention Carnival of Souls to Kiss fans, they always get pissed off when you say you like something from that record, or even like the record in general. And number 41, I have the song Rain off of that record, the 2nd track. The one that maybe probably should have been the single over Jungle, but I don't know, they really weren't promoting that album as much because they were doing the reunion tour at that time. The album was just kind of forced out because of bootlegs. But Paul Stanley is fantastic on this track. There's just something about it that packs that punch. Like, again, it's one of those songs where you couldn't see anybody else singing this song other than Paul Stanley. Though I originally think the demo was penned by Gene Simmons and the song sounded a lot different. But I guess Ace Frehley was like, I'll take this song and I'll change it up a bit so that way it fits me better. And my God, did it ever. Number 40 is Shandy. I mean, it's not the best song off of Unmasked, but it's the most memorable and most noticeable off of that record. It's their biggest hit from it. It's definitely more softer than what they usually do. It's just nice and catchy, and it's always stood the test of time to me, so that's something I think that I can appreciate from it. Red, the sailor's only daughter. Staying in the more softer territory, we have what I think is the best of the Peter Criss ballads, that being Hard Luck Woman off of Rock and Roll Over. This one just seems more like a Kiss song than Beth does. Beth has always sounded like a Peter Criss solo song to me, whereas at least with the instrumentation on Hard Luck Woman, you go, okay, there's a band behind this. This feels like Kiss other than Peter Criss just singing behind a piano. Plus, I think it's a lot catchier than Beth. Again, although I like both songs, Hard Luck Woman is hardly even mentioned and is so underrated, it's criminal. Hey, and we're sticking with a Peter Criss-led track off of Dynasty, Dirty Livin'. I mean, when you talk about what Kiss was looking for with the pop rock, almost kind of like, you know, disco-type sound for Dynasty, this worked very well. Now, as far as I remember, this record was produced by the guy who helped Peter Criss do his record. So maybe it was just because Peter Criss and this producer worked very well together already that it just kind of, you know, clicked. But Dirty Livin' was the only song that Peter Criss sang on and even performed on the whole entire Dynasty record. And throughout its 4.5 minutes, it's nice, from the band coming in at the end singing the chorus Dirty Livin' to, you know, Peter Criss kind of keeping his, I guess you can say, raspy vocals, you know, to a minimum in this song, and just doing an excellent job being able to make a banger. It's one that, again, goes underappreciated and I think should get more love than it does. Is Going Blind. Now, I know there's people out there that are gonna be like, you know, you rag on Christine 16 because, well, Gene Simmons sings about wanting to get with a 16-year-old, and in this song, Going Blind, there's the lyrics, I'm 93, you're 16, which, you know, basically insinuates that there was either a, you know, forbidden relationship between this 93-year-old and the 16-year-old, where someone is dating someone who was old enough to be their great-great-grandfather, but, you know, we never really understand or get what that line really means in general. Plus, that line was added in by Paul Stanley, so you can't really blame Gene Simmons for that creepy little line. But nonetheless, I feel like when you listen to Hotter Than Hell as a whole, just the way that album was produced and the way it sounded, Going Blind is, like, I think, the signature song of how that record overall was supposed to sound. It's slow, it's sludgy, but it's just something about it that makes it so likable. We have another one off of Dressed to Kill, Lover All I Can. This was one of the songs from the Wicked Lesnar era that carried over into Kiss for Paul Stanley and Gene Simmons, as they just rewrote it. And it's only like 2 minutes and 40 seconds, but my God, it's so catchy. The chorus, again, just something you can't help sing along to. It's another underrated song that I think doesn't get enough love. And I actually first heard this with a DVD I have, Kiss Rock the Nation Live, that they released in 2004, I believe, where they actually played this song. And I'm like, huh, that's an interesting song. I gotta listen to the studio version. And it was just as good as the live version. Alright, going back to No Makeup era Kiss with the same record, Asylum, Who Wants to Be Lonely? Another catchy little track that I feel like, you know, is still hair and glam metal, but with a Kiss tinge on it, so it sounds different from what we were hearing from that genre at the time. It's just nice, catchy, and concise. It doesn't do too much, although I think it carries on for a little bit too long. It just does its job at being this fun song overall. Album by Kiss that, you know, divides a lot of Kiss fans. I have seen people that will defend this record and like this record, that being the album Crazy Nights, and the title track, Crazy Crazy Nights, the lead off to this record, the first single, has always been a fan favorite to a lot of people, because I guess, you know, it's one of those songs on an album that's filled with keyboards that doesn't have too much keyboards to be visible, and the keyboards don't bother me. I just feel like a majority of that record, it all just feels like demos that they, like, forced out without even, like, you know, thinking about it. But this song, I really think, set the precedent for what that record was going to be like. And it's nice, it's uplifting, and just the way Paul Stanley sings on that thing, it's just a classic to me. We have I Was Made for Loving You. Why isn't it higher on this list? I don't know. I kind of get tired of it. Even though it's not as overplayed as Rock and Roll All Night and Beth, it still kind of gets played a lot elsewhere. And I'm just kind of like, you know, I feel like with Dynasty, it's a good song, but there's other really great songs on that record that get underlooked because this was the biggest hit off of it. But I can't deny it's a banger of a song. It's Kiss doing disco the right way and wasn't intentionally made that way so they can get on the radio and, you know, whatnot. Yeah, but there was nothing wrong with that back in the day, especially when you're talking about Kiss, so it shouldn't have been that surprising to begin with, but overall, the song just slaps. '32 is the not necessarily album closer off of Revenge, because Car Jam 1981 follows that, the little, you know, drum solo instrumental to commemorate the at the time deceased drummer, Eric Carr. I Just Wanna is a nice, interesting 4-minute track that kind of shows you what Revenge was all about when it came to that Kiss record. It has everything from, you know, just, you know, the nice guitars to Paul Stanley's sing-songy type voice. I do like the little a cappella section in the middle of it that kind of, you know, changes the song in general until you get back into the song. It's a nice bridge, and it's always been another underrated Kiss single to me because this had a music video film for it and was put out there and played on the radio, but it doesn't get enough recognition, I think. It's a nice song from the Kiss No Makeup era, probably their last really good single from that era in general. I had to include this song here, the title track to the album Psycho Circus, because you think about it, this was a really good moment for a lot of people. The original lineup of Kiss was back, and although we know now that Ace Frehley and Peter Criss didn't have much to do with the recording of this record or this song, it was still nice to just see the music video, them all back in makeup, back together, playing again. And for whatever reason, Tommy Thayer, who at the time was the band's manager, actually didn't think the song was gonna work. They almost kept it off the record, but Paul Stanley insisted, and it ended up kicking off the record and doing it in just an excellent, excellent fashion. Like, just when you thought Kiss was kind of just like, you know, the original members are back, but are we really gonna get something that heavy? They just blew your mind, and to this day, it's one of my favorite Kiss album openers, because again, it sets the tone from what to expect moving forward when we talk about the album itself. Alright, alright, this is the last one off of Carnival of Souls, I Swear. Even though I do like pretty much a majority of that record, there's two standout songs. We talked about one, that being Rain, and now we have Master and Slave. This is the one that I think people said should have been the lone single other than Jungle. It's just 5 minutes, Paul Stanley, great vocal performance. I love the bass line by Gene Simmons throughout the verses. Chorus is catchy, and the chorus does kind of change a little bit by the end of it as you move on into the song. Bruce Kulick's guitar work is excellent. There's a lot about this song to like, and it's Kiss doing the darker grunge sound in the correct way. I mean, this was not part of that demo session, so this was one of the songs that Paul Stanley sat down and, you know, wrote for himself. And again, it fit him so well, and it's a very underrated track. That's all I also have to say about it. I can't rock and roll to you. God Gave Rock and Roll to You 2, which basically Kiss kind of covered the song, but didn't. It's a cover, but it's rewritten to kind of make it their own, as they were asked to do this for the Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure soundtrack. I think that was the name of the second Bill and Ted movie. I can't remember for whatever reason. I always get the first and second movie titles mixed sometimes. And it wasn't intended to be on an album, but they put it on the Revenge album, I guess, as maybe some commemoration to Eric Carr, who didn't play on this track, but he was in the music video. He sang the little a cappella track, and obviously after that, or during that, he tragically passed away because of heart cancer. It's just a nice song to show you that at the time, Kiss still has it, and it was one of the first Unmasked era tracks that had Gene Simmons even anywhere near lead vocals. Sure, it wasn't a lot, but just to hear him back and invested, it was just like surreal. It was like, oh, he cares again. And he had more time to shine on Revenge than I think he did on any of the other No Makeup records. So this was just nice as everybody showed their talents. And I think it was a nice introduction to Eric Singer and what he was able to do as a drummer on this track in general. Lick It Up is a very mixed record, very top-heavy, but that opener, Exciter, ooh boy. I mean, Vinnie Vincent as a guitarist, man, he's fantastic. No matter what you think of him as a person, he was an excellent guitarist for the couple of records that he was on for Kiss, that being Creatures of the Night and Lick It Up. And Paul Stanley's vocals on here again, it's just like, the man kept growing his voice into what he was able to do. He pushed his boundaries, and to me, I look at the singles on the album, Lick It Up and All Hell's Breaking Loose, and I said, why couldn't you add Exciter to this list? I felt like this could have been a nice little, it's almost like hair metal mixed with thrash metal in a way. It was very, very interesting how the song played out, but to me, it opened the album nicely. At 27, we have Reason to Live, probably the biggest hit off of the album Crazy Nights, the more ballady type track. I was gonna say acoustic, but it's more the synths and the keyboards that carry this song. But, you know, I mean, the thing with Kiss is, yeah, their ballads can be very hit or miss at some point, but when they hit on these ballads, they really hit, as it sounds sympathetic, and I believe Paul Stanley's vocals when he sings songs like this. Like, there's nothing wrong with it in general. I've always felt like that when you look at Crazy Nights. The album should have been a lot more of this and a less of just trying to be like Bon Jovi or something like that. It added a lot to a record that needed stuff added to it. We're talking about Rise to It, the, again, album opener to probably their worst record, Hot in the Shade, which is 15 tracks long and just features a whole lot of nothing aside from a couple songs. But Rise to It is a nice way to open the record, as it still kind of, you know, continues what they did from Crazy Nights, just without keyboards. And it feels a lot more enthusiastic than a lot of the stuff we got from the record that came before it. It just is a nice example of Paul Stanley doing his thing for 80s Kiss. Alright, after three songs in a row without the makeup, we are going back to the makeup era with the album that was titled Unmasked, so still kind of confusing in a way, but yeah, we have She's So European. This is the Gene Simmons penned track from this record, and it's a nice one. I don't know what it is, it's just so catchy. The keyboards are nice, I like the way the instruments go, and Gene Simmons' vocals, again, are definitely different. You're not getting that growliness from him, it's more of a, you know, melodic type singing, and I think for what it is, it fits this more kind of power pop aesthetic that they were going for at the time with this record. And it's a highlight to me that, again, gets highly, highly underrated because of the single Shandy and maybe even other tracks on there that don't get enough love either. Get the fire out! It took took me long enough to get to the debut record, didn't it? But at number 24, we have Firehouse. Just a nice 3.5 minute song that, you know, again, is slow and chuggy, but Paul Stanley and Gene Simmons' vocals coming together on the chorus make it a whole lot of fun. And, I mean, yeah, who doesn't like a good innuendo of, girl, you're really hot, we need to call the fire department. You got nothing to lose. Back to the self-titled debut album, We Have Nothing to Lose. I know, again, this is a song where you listen to the lyrics and it's kind of weird because, and this has been confirmed by Gene Simmons, the song is about
butt sex.
The first lines you're gonna hear are, before I had a baby, I tried every way, I thought about the back door, didn't know what to say. She didn't want to do it, but she did anyway. It's kind of like, in my head, it was almost like, you know, they had the kid together and they're like, we don't want kids, but we still want to, you know, get freaky sometimes. So this man that Gene Simmons is talking about, you know, said, well, what about if we, you know, do it doggy? You know, you're not going to get pregnant that way.
Butt sex.
And, you know, at first the wife or girlfriend or whatever is hesitant, but then she's like, you know what? I think that might work. The song, again, is just catchy from Gene Simmons' verses to Peter Criss singing the chorus. It's almost kind of jazzy in a way. It's very interesting. And I don't know, there's something satisfying about it. "22" is the title track of the album of the same name, Hotter Than Hell. Again, slow, very sludgy at times, but it's just a signature song from the early Kiss days that they still love to play live for the sheer fact that it's just a whole lot of fun. "21" is Tomorrow and Tonight off of Love Gun. This was them kind of, I guess, trying to replicate the success that Rock and Roll All Night and Shout It Out Loud had, where it was supposed to be more of a, you know, party group oriented type thing. And although it didn't work out, I've still always had a soft spot for this song. This actually, if you think about it, could fit very well on Dynasty. Like, people talked about Kiss going disco in the 1979 album, but they kind of started hinting toward it with Love Gun, with a couple of songs, this being one of them. But again, even though toward the end it does get a little bit annoying and repetitive, as around the 2:40 mark, they just, you know, continue saying tomorrow and tonight, until the end mark at about, like, 3:40. It goes on for, like, a solid minute at the end. You still just can't help but sing along because it just catches your attention that quickly. Number 20, we have All Hell's Breaking Loose off of Lick It Up. This was actually Kiss doing some sort of, like, rap rock almost, as Paul Stanley kind of sings on the verses, but it's more of like a talk singing in a way. He's kind of explaining things, and then of course you get to the chorus where the group comes together, and I believe this was one of the songs too, a few songs during that time, that Eric Carr actually helped write. So hey, you know, I mean, I guess this was kind of maybe partially his idea in a way, like, let's try this, see where this goes. Even though 1983, I don't really know if a bunch of rap rock was really popular. I mean, I guess Run DMC was popular at the time, and the Beastie Boys hadn't quite yet popped off, so, you know, it was Kiss definitely taking a risk, but it fit. But again, when you look at Lick It Up, the album probably really is more of an oddball than you think. Then at 19, we have Creatures of the Night, the title track and the kickoff of the same name. This one just solidifies what the album entails in itself. It's so excellent. Paul Stanley taking lead vocals on it. I just love everything about it, from its dark, eerie feeling to just the way Paul Stanley sings. It's excellent. The closer to the 1974 self-titled debut, Black Diamond, pretty much sang by Peter Criss, even though Paul Stanley sings the beginning. This shows Peter Criss's more rockin' side, you know, more, I don't want to say heavier side, because Black Diamond's not necessarily a heavy song, but when you think of Peter Criss, you think of the more, like, subtle songs, the more, like, you know, jazz-leaning R&B songs, kind of, but this one really shows off what he's able to do as a rock vocalist, and it's a just a nice way to close the album and finish things off. Love Gun, again, another title track off of an album of the same name. Paul Stanley's so proud of this song, and I see why. It's just a nice song about, you know, hey, you're so just taken in by this girl's looks and love that she basically hits you with her quote-unquote love gun. It's fun and serves its purpose. Number 16, we have Heaven's on Fire off of Animal Eyes. This is an album that I'm very critical of, but Heaven's on Fire is probably the biggest highlight off the record in general. Again, it's very fun, although it's about a girl, you know, being like, oh my god, girl, you're so hot that heaven is on fire, I can't escape you and whatever. There's just something about it that, again, sets it off from what was coming out during that hair metal era in general. Shock Me in the top 15? I know. Yeah, right? This is the first time we heard Ace Frehley take lead vocals, and this is based off of a real-life event that happened to him, where during a show, there was some wire that wasn't grounded correctly, and when he touched the railing, that wire shocked him. Luckily, it shocked him backwards instead of forward, where he would have dropped about 10 to 15 feet to what ultimately would have been his death. And of course, even though he had no feeling in his hand afterwards, Ace Frehley finished the show. I think it's just a nice way to kind of introduce yourself, as for years, Ace Frehley was just so shy to take lead vocals, because he's actually wrote a lot of Kiss's songs early on that are really well known, like Parasite being one of my favorites. It's just the fact that we got to hear him on vocals for the first time and him kind of break out of his shell was nice, and I think too the fact that the song was based off of a true event that he was able to write about even made it more like genuine. Number 14, I Still Love You, a Kiss ballad that needs more love than I think it does. Like, people who aren't Kiss fans need to hear this. It's 6 minutes, but it is just genuinely, like, fantastic. Whether you're listening to the album version or the version on MTV's Unplugged, Paul Stanley is just excellent on here. Everything about it just, I don't know, again, it's just Creatures of the Night had that eerie feeling to every song, and adding a song like this onto an album that was mainly just heavy, it's an oddball, yes, but my god, it is excellent. Number 13, the closer to the album Hotter Than Hell, Strange Ways, which sees Peter Criss taking lead vocals. He does a nice job, and of course when the chorus comes in, Gene Simmons, you kind of hear his voice. It's just a nice track of, I guess you can call it a grunge track, way before grunge was even like a thing. It's very interesting to think that Kiss did a grunge album in 1997, but it wasn't fully grunge, and yet with Hotter Than Hell, that album could be categorized as somewhat grunge in a way just for the way it sounded. Strange Ways just has that sludginess that makes it so interesting to listen to, and Strange Ways is a highlight. Staying on Hotter Than Hell, we have Got to Choose at number 12. This is the kickoff to the record, and although I felt like it didn't make a fantastic kickoff, it's still a song that, again, they sing live to this day because, well, it's a good song. It's just Paul Stanley singing about Paul Stanley things about, you know, this girl and him. It's kind of like, you know, do you love me or do you love him? You gotta choose one or the other. It's as simple as that. Number 11, the short but sweet Come On and Love Me off of Dressed to Kill. Again, Dressed to Kill is known for being Kiss's shortest record because a lot of those tracks fall under the 3-minute mark, but a lot of those songs just get straight to the point and you get attached to them immediately. And Come On and Love Me has always been one that's been very nice. They actually technically made this a single when they were doing the promos for Kiss Alive, as they kind of gave it a, you know, music video in some sort of way for that promotion. So people liked it then, and people still like it now. All right. To kick off the top 10, we have Strutter, the song that started it off for them, kicking off their debut record. I mean, it's just a classic. That's all I have to say. It really, really is. Like, the fact that I put this on here and left Deuce off the list might be a little bit questionable to people because they do sing Deuce more than Strutter. But I don't know. Strutter is just the perfect kickoff to a record. Like, hey, we're Kiss. This is the band that we are. It's the first song you ever hear from them on a record. So it needs to make a good first impression, and it definitely does. Number 9 is the best Kiss ballad ever, and I don't care what people say. The Michael Bolton pen track, it was co-written by Michael Bolton and Paul Stanley, and you can definitely see that Michael Bolton co-wrote it, because you can probably see him singing it. It's just, I think, the biggest highlight off of Hot in the Shade. I don't know what it is about it that gets me so attached to it, but it's been probably my favorite Kiss ballad since I first heard it. Like, there's nothing like Paul Stanley singing the way he sings on this. The drums by Eric Carr is fantastic, and even the little acoustic guitar solo by Bruce Kulick is, like, nice. Like, this song has no business being this nice and romantic, but yet, here we are. Number 8, 2000 Man, in my opinion, the best Ace Frehley lead vocal performance. Even though it is a cover of a Rolling Stones song, Ace Frehley just puts his own little spaceman tinge onto it and does an excellent job throughout the 5-minute track, just being able to sing. The guitar work is fantastic. Again, it's kind of an oddball on Dynasty because it's less sounding of what they wanted to go for on that record in its entirety, but in the end, Ace Frehley just knows how to be cool and make your typical rock and roll song. Number 7, this was the return of Gene Simmons and the Demon Persona during the No Makeup era, as this was the technical lead single to their 1992 album Revenge, even though God Gave Rock and Roll to You came out before this, was never intended to be on the album in the first place, so Unholy was supposed to be the track that kicked off this era, and it was the first single during the No Makeup era where it was just completely Gene Simmons on lead vocals. He was back, he was caring again. This was Kiss delving into the grunge when it was really popular at the time, and holy shit, it worked. They kicked the album off with this, which I think was a smart decision in general. This is one of the signature Gene Simmons songs just overall for very good reasons, as he just checks off the box as to what to expect from a Gene Simmons-led song. It's just fantastic. Number 6, Tears Are Falling off of Asylum. I mean, yeah, it's like a mini ballad, because it's not necessarily a ballad, but when you look at the album Asylum, it's kind of the softest track on here. I mean, we do get some nice guitar work by Bruce Kulick, especially that solo. And there's something about Paul Stanley's voice on this song that he's never done before, where like during the verses, it's kind of like high, low, kind of, you know, type thing. Even though the chorus is repetitive, it just goes nicely and still feels like, you know, it still feels like it fits the album of Asylum, although it is way different from anything else on that record. Alright, top 5, I Stole Your Love, Love Guns opener. Again, always been one of my favorites, just with the way it's able to show you that Love Gun is going to sound like this, and this is how it's going to be. Paul Stanley has excellent vocal work on here. I like the little echoes that he puts on his voice before you get into the chorus. Just excellent overall. Number 4 is actually the better single off of Dynasty. I like I Was Made for Loving You, but Sure Know Something doesn't get enough love. And again, this has always been one of my favorite Kiss songs. I just like the bass line at the beginning from Gene Simmons. That's one thing you can say about Dynasty, is even though Gene Simmons doesn't take the helm at leads vocals a lot, he definitely has a lot of good bass moments on that record, and this is one of them. And this is kind of like the other song on the record where I can say Kiss kind of pushes the disco limits, but it is a hell of a song, and I think should have been bigger than I Was Made for Loving You, but, you know, sometimes mistakes are made. Then at number 3, we have Shout It Out Loud. Again, people might be upset for me putting this on the list and not Rock and Roll All Night, but Shout It Out Loud doesn't get enough credit for basically being the sequel to that song, where it's basically just another, hey, get up and party, have a good time song. Paul Stanley and Gene Simmons both sing on this track. It's short, sweet, and to the point, and definitely fits the sound of what Destroyer ended up being. Number 2, you probably thought I was going to put this at number 1, but Detroit Rock City is like the signature Kiss storytelling song based upon a true story about a Kiss fan who was going to attend a show in Detroit, but, you know, had a little bit too much to drink and would end up crashing and passing away during that crash, and Kiss decided, let's make a song based off of that. It's just nice, well put together. Of course, that opening guitar riff is just so memorable, like everybody knows it at this point in time. I can't help but love the way it turned out. So what is my number one choice for the best Kiss song, at least in my opinion? There's so many decisions on here. There's also a couple of songs that I haven't mentioned that you're probably like, will it end up on the list or won't it? Well, I can tell you, you're gonna be disappointed with some of the songs that I left off the list, but number one just has to be my favorite for the pure fact that this is Kiss at their heaviest, and I really don't think they got any heavier than this. Controversial decision, because I know there are fans that do like Creatures of the Night but aren't necessarily fans of this song for being, I guess you can say, the most mainstream off of Creatures of the Night, but I Love It Loud is your signature Gene Simmons track, and I don't know, it's just loud, but it's not obnoxious. That drum beat by Eric Carr that just goes all the way through is just so perfect to encapsulate what the song ends up being, which is just a monster of a song, and frankly the one that I think should have probably kicked off Creatures of the Night, but who am I to judge? Either way, they put it on the album. It's an excellent song, and this was an album where Gene Simmons actually did more than Paul Stanley. Not saying Paul Stanley didn't contribute, but Gene Simmons has more lead vocal performances on this album alone than Paul Stanley does, and this song is just one of the many highlights on that record in general, and has always been my sheer favorite for the fact that it's just like, I don't know what it is about it. What really attached me to it was when I saw them live in 2009. This was the song that Gene Simmons did his bass solo for and spat the blood out before ultimately getting into the song as he was up in the rafters with blood, you know, the fake blood just spilling down his face, and I was like, this song is badass and will forever be my favorite Kiss song. Nothing will surpass it. Even the likes of Detroit Rock City and others that, you know, you would probably rank ahead of it, this to me is the signature Kiss song that really, you know, made me appreciate what they were able to do, especially when they had their heavier moments. So that is it for my top favorite Kiss songs of all time, 50 of them to be exact. You can tell me in the comments below, what are your favorite Kiss songs? Doesn't necessarily have to be top 50, just what are the ones that stick out to you the most, and what are the ones that you listen to the most? It can be from any era, from any bandmate singing, I don't care. It just has to be a Kiss song. Nothing from the solo records, because again, even though those are Kiss products, I don't count them as Kiss songs because that's not what they were nor what they were intended to be. So that's it for me. Stay safe out there. And I guess all I really have to say is thank you, Kiss, for being there for about 18 years of my life and really, really getting me into music in general. I will miss you, and it will not be the same without you.